Praise the Lord, brothers and sisters, and welcome for today's prayer meeting. Let's all sign ourselves together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My dear brothers and sisters, I'm very much sure that all of you are praying for this pandemic. Whether it is in your prayer time, whether it is in the Holy Rosary with your family, all of us are praying, and we, in a way, are soldiers of Christ. And so let us remember, brothers and sisters, that even if we are there stuck in our homes, we are still soldiers of Christ and we are there in this battle. And this particular battle is not won by us as such, but it is won by the Lord Himself, because the battle belongs to the Lord. I want to remind you and tell you about a wonderful incident of which happened in the book of 2 Chronicles in chapter 20. Where the king of Judah was praying to God, and he made a prayer saying that we do not know what to do, but we look to you, God. And rightly, even we ourselves, we are also in a fix and we are praying the same thing. Lord, we do not know what to do, but we look to you, O Lord. Later on, the prophet Jahaziel came to the people of Judah and to the king saying, "You must not be discouraged or afraid to face this large army. This battle is not yours, but of God's." And so, brothers and sisters, this situation that we are facing is not ours, but it is of God's. This battle belongs to God. He is the one who will give us victory in this. Amen. And so, even as we are convinced that this battle is not ours, but of God, let us sing and worship Him.
In heavenly armor, we'll enter the land.
The battle belongs to the Lord.
No weapon that's fashioned against us shall stand. When your enemy presses in heart, Glorify your name, O Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. King of kings and Lord of lords. Yes, Lord. The battle belongs to the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise your holy name, O Lord. Glorify you, Jesus. Bless you, Lord. Bless you, Jesus.
Alpha,
thank you,
Maker.
Hallelujah. 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 You're worthy of all our praises, Lord.
Praise the Lord. Brothers and sisters, I want to ask you a question. Do you believe in Jesus? I'm sure that you do. So if you believe in Jesus and I believe in Jesus, let's sing and praise Him. Let's keep our hands over our hearts at this time and surrender ourselves to the Son of God, declaring our faith, our complete selves, declaring that we believe in Him. Lamb of God, we worship you. We give you all the glory and honor, for you alone deserve it all. All the elders and all the angels and saints sing holy, holy, holy. For it is you, O Lord, who are worthy of all our praise, of glory and of honor. We love you, Lord, and we worship you.
Thank you.
Praise the Lord, brothers and sisters. Welcome to the Monday prayer meeting. Today, I'm going to talk on the topic God the Son. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, three persons in one God. And then today we are going to focus in God the Son. As per the catechisms of the Catholic Church, we always profess our faith, I believe in God the Father. And that is the Apostles' Creed. Our Christian belief and faith confesses that God is one in nature, in substance, and in essence. God is in nature, substance, and essence one. Three persons in one God contains this nature, substance, and essence. Last week, we heard about the attributes of God. God's attributes, divine attributes, was essenity, means God is self-existing, self-sufficiency. Eternity of God, it means God is existing beyond time. That's why we say the Alpha and the Omega. Then we have the holiness of God. God is incorruptible and separated from sin. Then we have the goodness of God. God is full of kindness, mercy, and compassion. See, when somebody asked, Jesus said, no one is good except God. So that's the goodness of God. Then we have the graciousness of God, slow to anger, and kind and faithful. So these were the attributes of God, which in short is the nature, substance, and the essence of the God. Now we have the Most Holy Trinity. Most Holy Trinity is a central mystery of our Christian faith of life. It is the mystery of three persons in one God. Now many people try to understand this mystery. But this mystery is hidden in God Himself. The mystery is God Himself. It is very difficult to understand. Saint Augustine tried to unravel this mystery, but he was not contented. And that's why, you know, in Matthew 11:27, Jesus says, no one knows the Son except Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone whom the Son chooses to reveal him. So it will be revealed, this mystery is revealed. And no matter you can find to unravel, we may not be satisfied. And that is why in the year 325 AD, there was an assembly council in Nicaea. And in Nicaea, this mystery was again reaffirmed by the Apostles' Creed. We converted them in a reaffirmed state as a Nicene Creed, in which it was revealed that the Son is consubstantial with the Father, means one God with Him. And of course, afterwards the Holy Spirit is also revealed with Jesus, consubstantial. So Trinity in one God. Now this Nicene Creed, if you remember, it starts with, we believe in one God. We believe in Jesus Christ, only Son of God, eternally begotten. Eternally begotten. As I said, eternal means there is no beginning, no end. So Jesus Christ was begotten with the Father eternally. He was not made. He existed. It means begotten, not made. He was not made. He existed. He is not an offspring. For us, and then it says the Nicene Creed, for our salvation, He came down from heaven. Who? The Son of God. So we have God the Father, God the Son, and the God the Holy Spirit in this Blessed Trinity. And our Christian belief has to be very strong in this mystery. God the Son was sent by God the Father with a mission. What was his mission? He came down from heaven for our salvation, for us and for our salvation. So he came down as a Messiah and a Savior. That was the mission for what he was sent. And for that, he had to become flesh. And that's why we say the Word was made flesh. The church calls it incarnation. He assumed into human nature to accomplish the salvation in man. True God and true man. 100% God, 100% man, inseparable. Some theologians say that it was an hypostatic union. Jesus, when he was in earth, demonstrated his power. So when he was in the mission, we later hear God the Holy Spirit, that also comes with a mission. And when the Messiah was sent for a salvation, he was sent also to redeem us from the sins and evil. Throughout his public life, Jesus demonstrated his power. His power over the nature, he calmed the storm. His power over the illness, he healed many people, incurable disease. His power over demons, the demons were afraid of him, he drove the demons. His power over death, the dead was raised. And his power over sin, he could forgive sins. Yes, we are not only to focus on this part of his mission. The mission was only to demonstrate, but his real mission is, as a Son of God, he has come to give us salvation and redeem us on our sin. Now the Son of God, we are to focus on God the Son. God the Father acknowledges him in so many ways in the scriptures. We can remember in the two solemn appearances that he had during baptism and during transfiguration. God the Father said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Well, in Matthew 16:19, the disciple confesses that you are Messiah, Son of the living God. Even the demons in Matthew 8:29, they shouted, "What do you have to do with us, Son of God? Have you come to torment us before time?" And in John 5:25, Jesus himself referred himself as Son of God. And that's why later in John 19:7, the Jews screamed to crucify him because he claimed to be the Son of God. And of course, yeah, let's not forget Martha. Martha, when her brother was raised, she confessed that you are Messiah, the Son of God. So the belief in Son of God is distinctive sign of our Christian faith. My dear brothers and sisters, we have to focus on this Son of God. Jesus said, "I am in my Father and the Father, I and the Father is one." John 14:19-20. He has came down to redeem us for the salvation and for us. Perhaps he had dominion and authority over all the things on this world, but his main mission was that he came down for our salvation. We, my dear brothers and sisters, has to focus on him, that Lord, you as a Messiah and a Savior has to come to give us salvation. Try to spend some time with him every day in your personal prayer. Receive him in the Eucharist whenever possible, so that in his real presence is felt with him. By the blood of Lamb, he has won salvations, and by the blood of Lamb, we will be saved. Praise God. Hallelujah.